Ho ho ho, and welcome to episode 205 of the TEW 2020 Challenge Run. This is going to be Monday Night Raw for week 3 of December 2021, and we're on the road to High Voltage, but it's also the Christmas special, a very Raw Christmas. It's going to be, if I remember last year, it was really silly and like basically non-canon, but there was actually a lot of story development happening on this show. But yeah, it's there is also a lot of fucking goofiness, and the rest of the actual Christmas I'll be saving for SmackDown. But without any further ado, let's jump straight into the show. I do think it's funny that I am currently recording this on the 23rd of December, but I just put up last week's Raw today, and then SmackDown will go up tomorrow, so this will actually be going up on Christmas. This is my Christmas gift to you all, I guess. And we start off with Becky and Kaylee Ray and Nikki Cross. And she's like, it's funny, I thought that last week I was supposed to find out which one of those two was going to be the number one contender for my title, but we didn't have a winner. Now, I'm not going to sit here and pretend to be dumb. Champions throughout the years have caused non-title matches to where there were no contests. I'm not going to sit here and go, golly gee, I'm not going to defend my title against either of them at High Voltage because Shane McMahon or whatever B-list celebrity who's not as big time as me, one of them two will come out here and they'll tell me why. Actually, Becky, you're going to face both at the High Voltage, or they're going to face each other one-on-one tonight again, with no interference from you. I get this, but does this not prove my point to you that I'm not scared of these women? If I'm willing to go out there and make it a triple threat, then surely I don't mind it being a triple threat because I know I can win it. I'm not scared of Tony Storm or Raquel. That's when this week's Christmas special guest, Mr. Jack Black, interrupts. And he's like, Becky, 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 look. First of all, hi. Happy holidays. Merry Christmas. She's like, Merry Christmas to you too, Jack Black. Now what do you want? And he's like, listen, I came here bearing news from Shane McMahon that you will defend the Raw Championship against both Tony Storm and Raquel Gonzalez at High Voltage. And she's like, there it is. Yep. Told ya. But is that all you wanted, Jack? And he's like, well, no. We need to sort of tune up Raquel and Tony. See? Get them ready for this pay-per-view. So they're going to be in action right now against you. And Becky's like, well, I'm not cleared to compete because of my knee. I busted open carrying this show. And Jack Black's like, no, you're you. You two behind you are going to be in tag team match against them right now. So, good old Jack Black is here, and he's made a tag team match. Tony Storm and Raquel against Kaylee Ray and Nikki Cross. And bang, the match gets a 73. It is the singles wrestlers who win. Tony Storm pins Nikki Cross with the Storm Zero. 61 for Nikki, 70 for Kaylee Ray, 68 for Raquel, and a 65 for Tony. That's nice. We then get Jack Black chilling in his office when Frankie comes in again. She's like, oh my god, hi. And he's like, can I help you? She's like, well, I'm a massive fan. And you are one of the finest comedic actors of this generation. He's like, I appreciate the compliment. He's like, well, I was just wondering, since you're always such a busy man in Hollywood, I was wondering if you could get me an opportunity. And Black's like, what? He's like, you can, I know, an acting gig, musical gig, I don't know if you still do the music, I can sing really well, I don't know if you know. And she's like, he's like, okay, well, let's hear some lines. She's like, oh, no, not now, not now. And Naomi's like, bitch, shut your dumb ass up. And she walks in. It's like, I'm sorry, Tech, but you can ignore everything this wench is saying because she's just trying to suck up to you like she tried to suck up to Snoop last week. And she's like, I am not. I am looking for a great business opportunity. And Naomi's like, well, you can kiss my ass, girl, and I'll get out of here. So, well, the celebrity guests, you gotta have some heel try and suck up to him. Frankie's gimmick is she's basically Trina from Victorious at this point, like just trying to suck up to famous people to get opportunities, and like keep saying, oh, I'm great at singing, but she'd be shit, but we don't actually ever get to hear her sing. And Naomi's just like, I guess another analogy, she is like fucking, I guess, Brock Krogunk, who has to pull him away from what a random assortment of characters we've got here on this show. Speaking of an assortment of characters, it wouldn't be Christmas without some Christmas carols. So we get a pre-tape of J-Flo knocking on people's doors singing Christmas carols. And obviously, because they're heels this year, they get the door slammed in their face a fair bit. And Mackie's like, no, this is poo, 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 poo. And they go on the next door, open the door, like, you want to hear some Christmas carols? And they're like, no thanks. So that's the door. She's like, ah! And goes to the next door, knocks on the door, it's like, hi, we crave Merry Christmas carols. And they're like, oh, okay, I'm here for some carols. And they start singing, and then they don't like, they're sort of like wincing. Go, actually, I'm good. And the door shuts, and then we get angry Mackie and J-Flo stamping their feet because Christmas has been ruined because they couldn't go caroling. 48. Ridge Holland defeats Mario Truman in 201 by pinfall. Truman gets a 61 and a 51 for Ridge. Truman is basically Ronnie Hughes 2.0. He was a random regen who also came in with 60 pop. And yeah, I want to see how he do on this show against... So he gets the job against Ridge. He was off his game and got a 61, so he probably is actually good. I think this one's a former kickboxer, not a former football player. But he's another regen who came in a fairly oldish age and like had a decent amount of popularity to give. So I thought, hey, I'll see how he does. Like, I tried Ronnie out on Raw once against Andrade. Backstage segment. It wouldn't be Christmas without Jack Black giving us his also very special guest here tonight, the Santa Claus, live and in the flesh. And of course, it's not the real Santa Claus, it's Mick Foley. He's, ho, 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 I'm here to give you the Christmas spirit. And we see Aaliyah and Brandy getting ready for the match. They're like, hey, girls. Or they're not actually getting ready for the match. They don't know they've got a match yet. She's like, what can Santa get you two for Christmas? And she's like, well, we'd quite like a match tonight on this show against Dominion, teaming with Sonya Deville. And Foley's like, excellent, I'll go speak to Jack Black and get that match made. And he's like, oh, you're a big scary boy. He walks up to Luchasaurus. He's like, here, some dinosaur treats for thee. And he hands Luchasaurus some dinosaur treats. And he growls and hugs Mick and walks off. And then he turns around and Bobby Lashley and MVP there's like, what's this dumbass doing? And he's like, Jack Black's like, is there a problem here? He's like, you know damn well there's a problem here. This is the second week in a row we've had celebrity guests making a mockery of this place while the Almighty has a sit on the sidelines. We've got WWE Hall of Famers walking around here enabling this. But I don't care. Give a damn about Christmas. We'll spend Christmas with our families, not on Raw. Now, can you get the Almighty a match tonight? And Black's like, well, I think we're fully booked. I think we've got space for one more match. And Jeff Hardy's like, whoa, what's the matter, MVP? Do you know you're not in the Christmas spirit, dude? I am. And he's like, I don't get you. Shut your dumb ass up, Hardy. Why don't you fight the Almighty tonight if you're in such a giving mood? And he's like, okay, but Gables, do you want to make it official? And he's like, sure. And then we get Lashley and MVP. And then bang, R-Truth walks up. I actually haven't thought about who he'd call him. What would he call Jack Black? Who would he think Jack Black is that isn't Jack Black? Who's another old, fat, white guy actor? I don't know, but he'd call him somebody that isn't Jack Black. And he'd be like, no, no, Truth. I'm not, whatever name he calls him, like, I'm Jack Black. He's like, okay, dog, you can't fool me. Anyway, Merry Christmas, dog. And then he sees the title over his shoulder, and of course, like all celebrity guests, Jack Black rolls up R-Truth 1-2-3 to win the 24/7 title. And it's like, oh, dog, that ain't cool. That's so not Christmas. Angel Garza is chilling. Because it's Christmas, he's got a special, like, mistletoe stand. And he's like, hey, who wants a kiss from Garza on Christmas? And then the first people to walk past are Raquel and Tony Storm, who just won. And him and Raquel sort of give each other an awkward look. Because, like, in WWE canon, like, they broke up. But it wasn't like, oh, I'm going to turn on him. It's just like, hey, we're not together anymore. So that's because the game made them an awkward pairing, which I'm still annoyed at because the whole Eddie-China dynamic I thought was really fun, but the game disagreed. So they're broken up and it's sort of an awkward look. And she's like, what are you doing? And Tony's like, hey, remember when me and you fought over this guy? And then I was like, oh, yeah, now we're fighting over the championship. I'd say that's a bit of upgrade, wouldn't you, Tony? It's like, yeah, yeah, anyway, and they keep on walking off, and neither of them give Garza a kiss, and he's getting angry because he's got his mistletoe, and he's like, who wants to kiss this little sexy man? Because that is a shoot. I remember there was a Raquel and Tony feud, like, a couple of months ago where it started because Tony flirted with Garza, back when Tony was a heel. And, yeah, just a fun Christmas segment because Garza would have his... This won't be the last you've seen of him tonight. I finally found something for him to do. Ilya Dragunov is here with Joseph Connors. He says, Volta has more important things to do than to spend Christmas at the PPG Paints Arena. But he will be here next week for the Go-Home Show for High Voltage to really let Cesaro go face-to-face with Cesaro ahead of their match at the pay-per-view. But me and Connors are here tonight, and we're here to be Grinches and humbug your Christmas. Let me hear the shredding of a guitar. My name's Rick. Boogs, and he's here to rock and roll on Christmas with a Christmas hat on with Shinsuke, who are in the proper Christmas mood, and we're having a tag team match. I can't remember if this is the Miracle on 34th Street fight or if that was the opening match. One of them was. I think it was this. Or was it? No, anyway, there'll be a note on screen. Fucking let future Connell deal with that. Anyway, Blitzkrieg get the win. They beat Nakamura and Boogs in 9 minutes when Dragunov pins Rick Boogs with... I'm not even going to pretend to try and pronounce that. 60 for Connors, 74 for Dragunov, 51 for Boogs, and 89 for Shinsuke. So I've made a point just to give Dragunov and Connors wins in recent weeks because... I was very quickly falling into the trope of, oh, they're the lackeys, they're just going to get beat in singles matches ahead of the pay-per-view match with Walter. Which, like, I don't want to do that because that's not really an NXT UK group taking over, that's Walter and a bunch of shit lackeys. So we need to show that these guys are good. and they beat Nakamura. They pin Boog, so Shinsuke's still kind of doing good, but yeah, Christmas may be ruined by the evil Grinches. We're back at Garza's mistletoe stand, and he's waving out. He gets excited because he sees three women walk up to him. He's like, "Who wants a kiss with Garza on Christmas?" And Sonya Deville walks up, and she's the first. She's at the front, and she's like, "You do know I'm..." "Never mind." And she walks off, and I leave my brandy with her. And he's like, "Hey, he wants a Christmas kiss." Like, "Sorry, we're in the zone. We haven't got time to waste on men tonight." And he's like, "Ugh, fuck's sake." So, still no women wanting to kiss Angel Garza under the mistletoe tonight. Backstage segment. The main event is the six-man tag. Edge, Drew, and Keith against Balor, Scott, and Escobar. And Edge is in his locker room, and he's in his gear, he's getting all psyched up, ready for the match, when the door opens, and it's Drew with a Santa hat on. He's like, "Ho, ho, ho, it's Christmas." And Edge is like, "Ah, very funny, but come on, we've got a match to prepare for." He's like, "Hey, Adam, don't be a bummer. Get in the spirit, because I'm in the spirit, and we're going to go out there and we're going to kick some ass tonight in that main event. And once we do, we'll celebrate with a good old glass of eggnog and sing Christmas carols long into the night." And Edge is like, "I don't know about that one, Drew, but I'm sure down to win the main event." And then Keith Lee busts in. He's got like a tray of Christmas cookies and a Christmas hat on as well. He's like, "Ho! Feliz Navidad." I think that's Merry Christmas. Or, and then he offers, he's like, "Can I interest either of you gentlemen in a fine Christmas cookie?" And Edge is like, "What is happening here?" And Drew's like, "Yeah, sure, I'll have one." He's like, "Oh yeah, they're good. They're good. I've made them myself." And then Edge is like, "Focus. Listen. You can spend time with your family and celebrate Christmas any other day apart from tonight. But we've got to win the six-man tag team match. We need you in the zone. You two are on my team. I feel confident with you two on my team because you're two of the greatest here on Raw. You're two former World Heavyweight Champions. I need you to focus." And they're both just casually eating their cookies. Because Edge wants to win this main event, but these two want to celebrate Christmas. 80. I'm actually a little bit let down by that, given the ratings. I shouldn't be, but I am. Because fucking hell, look. 92, 78, 85, 87, 86, 85. Lack of psychology, apparently. But the babyface team, it's a Christmas miracle, because the babyfaces, Pete Dunne, the Cyclone, defeat Alpha Academy, Gable, Thatcher, and Otis. Bronson Reed pins Thatcher with the Tsunami. 92 for Ricochet, 78 for Reed, 85 for Pete, 87 for Otis, 86 for Thatcher, and an 85 for Gable. Gable did the lowest out of Alpha Academy? That is interesting. They get Jack Black chatting. He's like, "Let me get this straight. You're a real dinosaur?" And then pointing at the Luchasaurus, he's like, "Well, I mean, I'm not really per se, but I'm..." And then Tozawa's like, He big and scary dinosaur. Hiya." And Humberto's like, Yeah, he's a real dinosaur." And then Luchasaurus looks at them awkwardly. He's like, they're like, "Shh, it's Christmas, don't ruin the Christmas miracle." And then they walk off, and Jack Black's like, "Damn, there are some weird fucking people on this company." Then R-Truth was like, "I found you, dog." Rolls him up and takes the 24/7 title back. 1, 2, 3. It's like, "Yeah, I got my baby." 82 for the brawl between Bobby Lashley and Jeff Hardy. Goes 8:58, and Jeff has him beat. He hits the twist of fate. Lashley's down, goes up top for the swanton, when boom, Bray Wyatt on the Titantron. He's like, Hi Jeff, Merry Christmas, and I just want to let you know that I hope you're all still good. We've been tidying the place up, hoping that you're going to visit next Sunday, but I just need to let you know that you're still good to come, Jeff, and he's here waiting for you. He's so excited to meet you again, and that's all from me, bye-bye." And then obviously distracted, bang, hurt lock, and Jeff submits. 82 for Bobby, 83 for Jeff, and yeah, Bray Wyatt appears to have invited Jeff Hardy to the Firefly Funhouse at High Voltage. I'm sure that will be perfectly normal and not trippy whatsoever. Garza is back at the fucking... He sort of... You see him get more and more demoralized as more women don't kiss him. And then he sees Scarlett walk by. He's like, oh, can I have a kiss? And she's like... She looks around. She's like, sure. And she goes in. And then we hear... And Karrion Kross is there. He's like, move away, kid. And she's like, you mean me? He's like, yes, you. And then he grabs Garza by the throat and pins him up against the wall. He's like, listen here, kid. You dare go near my hot piece of ass ever again. Oh, I'll make you live. This will be your last Christmas. Because I'll rip your insides out, kid. And you need to learn not to throw stones in glass houses. Because when I'm in a glass house, I throw stones because I'm not afraid to get cut. But you are. And I'll cut you, kid. Down to size. Nothing personal. Drops him on the floor, and then Cross and Scarlet walk off. 75. That's actually pretty good, considering only Sonya and Asuka are actually over in this match. I mean, everybody's recognizable, but like the only ones that are actually at like over 50 pop are Sonya and Asuka. But the Dominion girls ruin Christmas for the baby faces. Asuka, Julia, and Micah defeat Sonya and Hot Property. Asuka submits Brandy with the Asuka lock. 55 for Brandy, 58 for Aaliyah, 73 for Sonya, 62 for Micah, 68 for Julia, and an 89 for Asuka. But then after that, we get a weird little face-off between Asuka and Sonya Deville, because Asuka keeps the Asuka lock locked in, and Sonya pulls her off, and then they get in each other's face, and then Asuka's like, nah, it's not worth it. Merry Christmas. But they looked sure they were going to fight. Whose show is it? It's LA Knight's Christmas show. And let me talk to you real quick, yeah? Last week, I got beat by that scumbag Oney Lorcan. And let me just tell you, I still hate the guy, but he's good in this ring. So what I'm going to give to you now, I'm going to give you a Christmas miracle here on the LA Knight Christmas show. I'm going to bury the hatchet with that guy. So come on out, Oney. And Oney comes out, he's like, wow, this is actually respectable of you. I didn't expect anything like this of you. Like, yeah, sit down. Let me talk to you real quick. Oney, listen here. You may not be as much of a megastar as LA Knight. You may not be as handsome as LA Knight. You may not be as charismatic as LA Knight. But you did get one over on me last week. And I've got to respect that, kid. And to that I say, Merry Christmas. And Oney's like, okay, Merry Christmas. He's like, well, what's next for you, Oney? How are you going to use the momentum from stealing a victory over me? And Oney's like, wait, what, stealing? But you just said that. He's like, no, shush. How are you going to use the momentum from stealing a victory over me last week to try and get back your World Heavyweight Championship after Finn Balor's done with Edge at High Voltage, yeah? And Oney's like, well, then shock the system. And then Adam Cole's like, this is dumb. Like, we came here to Raw to take over. We didn't come here on Raw to sit back and watch Christmas shows and Christmas carols. We came here to fight. And I know LA Knight's a bit of a coward, so he probably won't fight either of us, but Oney, you're in your gear and you're ready to go. Why don't you say you wrestle? And then Kyle takes the mic of Adam Cole. He's like, Adam. It's fine. I got this. You can wrestle me tonight, Oney, right now. And Oney's like, well, it's a Christmas miracle. I get to fight somebody. Adam Cole's like, Kyle, I was going to... He's like, no, I got it. It's fine. Oney and Kyle O'Reilly get a 78. If I put a storyline on this, it probably would have done a lot better. But because there was no storyline, I guess, that it doesn't only get a 78. So maybe I can run this back in the future. But Oney wins. He gets a Christmas dub over Kyle in 8:05 with a flying blockbuster. 90 for Kyle O'Reilly. And 85 for Oney Lorcan. Seeing Oney's face here just reminded me of something. I have cancelled all of our TV deals because we're now running Raw, SmackDown, and as well as Heat and Velocity on the network. Because in-game, there's not really a downside to it. It's going to help me make even more money. It's going to be more exposure because the network is enormous, whereas the TV deals were big. So, Oney was, like, capped at, like, 70, 71-ish popularity before, but seeing his face here has reminded me about us changing over to the network, because now it's on a grander scope, now it's on an enormous-sized network. A lot of popularity caps should hopefully go up. So hopefully that won't be as much of an issue going forward, and maybe if Oney gets super over again, I can factor him back in and maybe make him a two-time world champion. But the reason I took the belt off him was because he was capped at 70. Well, that and I had plans with Balor. But hopefully that won't be as much of an issue going forward if this works the way that I think it's going to. All hope seems lost for Gaza. Every single woman basically on the roster, apart from the ones the important ones. Unless that's harsh, because Sonya and Tony and Raquel, just the ones that he's spoken to, they've all said no. He hasn't spoken to Becky and Charlotte, but you can probably take a fucking guess what their answer would be. And then he sees Cynthia Crespo and Death From Above walk past. And he's like, he holds it up, he's sort of half-assed, he's like, please, please kiss me. And she's like, this is why I have these two with me. Because look at what you've reduced yourself to. This, look, Lince, Malik, this is what you could have become if you stayed on the track that you were on. Because Gaza, he's just out here begging for what some woman to give him, some lonely woman to give him attention on this Christmas night. Whereas we've got a Christmas party to attend, so let's move. And Gaza's all depressed. He's like, oh my god. And then he turns around. and standing there, with a shit-eating smile on her face. Oh, I fucking hate... I believe it was Jimmy who left this goal. There, standing smiling back at him, is Dixie Carter, who is like, hey babe, and he's like, holds the mistletoe up one last time, and Dixie gives Angel Gaza a kiss and walks off. And Gaza, he finally smiles, he finally got that kiss on this Christmas night. Under the mistletoe that he asked for. And it came from all people. Dixie Carter. I despise myself that I had Dixie ever since the goal was set to make her a manager for somebody. And had no fucking idea what to do. And this was what I came up with. Angel Garza. MILF Hunter is here. Oh, fuck off. Anyway, speaking of people being in love with women, Charlie's being interviewing the mosh pit again, and they're like, she's like, Liv, you've got a match with Jordan coming up next, and how are you feeling? He's like, you know, Miz has been trying to get in my head recently, but it's not working. I don't really listen to what that guy has to say, because he's a bit of a douche. But I will help my sister, Rhea, out by hopefully taking care of Charlotte's lackey, Jordan. And I've heard from Shane and Jack Black, of all people, that Ruby and Rhea aren't going to be at ringside, and Charlotte and Reggie aren't going to be at ringside, so it's just going to be me going alone. So, girls, you can head on back to locker room. Save me a seat at the table. I'll come join you after I'm done. And then Ruby and Rhea walk off. Then the Miz and the A-list walk up. And he's like, a bit of a douche. Those are the words you're going to use to describe me? A bit of a douche? That's somebody that's trying to help you, Liv. Somebody that's trying to put you on the billboards next to my face, because that's where you could be. You could be a star, but you won't be if you keep this whole thing up. And Liv's like, are you done? I've got a match to prepare for. Are you done? And Miz is like, oh, I'm done. But Alex, she She could use a co-star on the A-list's quest for the Women's Tag Team Championships, Livs, and I'd think you'd fit in perfectly in that role. Maybe I'll even talk to my casting director and get you an audition for that spot. And Liv's like, I don't want it, thanks. Poke it, now off you pop. And Miz is like, huh? Merry Christmas. And then the A-list all leave apart from Shanky. And Liv's like, can I help you? And Shanky just awkwardly looks down at Liv and hands her a box. He bought Liv a Christmas present. And just hands it to Liv and walks off. And she's like, thank you? Liv takes the Shanky present out with her for the match with Jordan for whatever reason. And Liv opens it up and there's like brass knuckles in there. And she's like, oh, okay, this is nice. Well, when she goes to hit him, she goes to hit Jordan with the brass knuckles. She puts them on and she's like, oh yeah, I'll use these, fine. She gets a shock. She's like, ah, like a static shock. Like one of those fucking zap rings where that shit happens. And then Liv screams in pain. She's like, ow! And then Jordan, bang, hits a big knee or whatever a finisher would be in this world to score the 1-2-3 and cheats to beat Liv because I don't need to spell it out for you. You can probably see what's going on here. Miz is using Shanky to pretend to be in love with Liv and then hand her the faulty Christmas present that resorted to her defeat. What a slimy bastard. But then Jordan is celebrating a win, then Charlotte and Reggie come out on the ramp and they're like, well done, that was great, woo. But it won't be as great as when I beat Rhea inside Hell in a Cell. Now, Rhea is not out here to come and attack me, so I can say this before security that Rhea is just jealous of me because I am so great, and she was compared to me from her first day in the company. That's because everybody aspires to grow up and be like Charlotte Flair in this business. When bang, from one of the presents stood on stage, one of the big boxes that they have on stage with the big presents, boom, Rhea's fucking boot just comes flying out. She's kicked the side of the box in. And she chases after Charlotte and they brawl around stage. She tosses Charlotte into the Christmas tree and all the presents and shit. That spot that happens on every Christmas Raw where the person gets thrown into like the fucking ornaments on the stage, that happens to Charlotte here at the hands of Rhea. 81 weighted main event is a little bit bleh, but it's fine, I'll take it. Drew, Keith Lee and Edge do win. They defeat Balor Club when Edge pins Finn with the spear. So Edge pinned, as they beat Escobar and Scott, Edge and Keith Lee last week. He's just pinned Finn Balor tonight. And that means there's only one member of Balor Club left. He grabs the microphone and he's like, well, ain't that a Christmas miracle? Now, let me tell you this. Finn, I've beaten you. If I do that again at High Voltage, I will win back my World Heavyweight Championship. I beat Escobar and Swerve last week with Keith Lee. That leaves only you. He points at Ridge Holland. And Ridge has his little bat. And he points at himself. He's like, me? He's like, yeah, you, big boy. How about next week? You show the world what you're really capable of when you step into the ring with a WWE Hall of Famer. You take it to the extreme and you go one-on-one with a rated R superstar. And Riton's like, fine, I'll beat your fucking ass, boy. And then Balor and Ridge leave, and Edge, Drew, and Keith just celebrate with the fans on a good old Christmas night. 85. Yeah, that's fine. I used Jack Black far too much. I disagree. I actually think he wasn't used enough. I mean, he was used enough, but, like, he wasn't all over the show. I think Snoop was in more segments than he was. But it's fine. What matters more than the 85, of course, is what you thought of the show, so let me know what you thought in the comments below. I hope you have had, or did have, or do have, a good Christmas, because it's going up on Christmas Day, I believe, because Christmas Eve is tomorrow, as I'm recording this, which will be when SmackDown goes up. So then, yeah. Which is actually ironic that this is going up bang on Christmas Day. And then, hopefully, if I get time to record before then, I've got until Boxing Day basically to record SmackDown to keep up the daily upload thing, but shit might drop off now and again based on obviously the holidays and me not having enough time, as much time to record. So if it goes a couple of days, don't assume I'm dead. If I'm dead, I'll let somebody let you know that I'm dead. And yeah, I'll see you next time for SmackDown 204, which will be, yeah, their Christmas show. See you then.